What it is, what's up? Got your video in the cut. Armor video. Just got out of the shower. And you know when you take a shower, you have your best ideas. It's going to be one of my worst. I'm going to do a Johni, Broome returns to Auburn video. But it's not going to be formatted the way you think it'd be. I got to, you know, God bless me with the ability to complain. So I'm going to complain real quick. And this is NSFW language, as a lot of my videos are. So just prepare yourself for it. 5, 4, 3, 2. These stupid fucking cocksuckers that sit here and complain about NIL fucking sicken me. So Johni Broome, who's a unanimous All-American, he was third team on the two relevant pollsters, All-American boards. Probably one of the 5, 10, 15 most successful Auburn players that Auburn has ever had. And I mean, if you just look at his accolades and his statistics, especially his advanced statistics, you kind of come to that conclusion pretty quickly. A guy that really held it down with some very fraudulent backcourts, to say the very least. Hey, nobody from any of those backcourts are currently on Auburn's roster. Nobody from 2022 or 2023. So I hope they won't be offended by this when they go off to University of Alabama or University of Michigan, and some of them are going. But yeah, one of the best players that Auburn's ever had. And, you know, it's just lovely when you kind of look at the mark and you see Omar Ballo, one of the kind of five best players in the talent of the cycle. Got about $1.2 million estimated from the University of Indiana, transferred from Arizona to there. Keep in mind, you know, Indiana developed Khalil Ware, who's probably going to be like a French first-round type of guy. They also had another big that we had played, we being Auburn, that was also a very talented individual. Also produced Trace Jackson Davis, who was getting, like, real minutes for a playoff-caliber team. So, you know, real center-slash-big development there. And, you know, I mean, he earned the bag. Like, he's one of the best defensive players out there. Indiana kind of is, like, doing everything they can to put out a competitive product so Michael Woodson doesn't get fired. You know, I mean, like, it's a proud basketball program. That's what you pay for a high-level guy of that caliber to come to your program. And I see with Broome, it's hypothesized that he got a similar bag. It was mentioned, I believe, in the On Three article that he had met, him and his family had met with Pearl, both kind of immediately after the season ended, as well as sometime this week, kind of just discussing, you know, his return. He's apparently always been between, like, pro or coming back, no transfer options. So this is how business is done. If you're an Auburn fan, and unfortunately, a lot of, you know, fans of athletic programs don't get the chance to go to college to, you know, kind of attend their favorite team, which I'm not complaining about that. They deserve to still support a team even though they didn't attend. As for a state that is, it's not as affluent, which means poor. Say it's poor as Alabama, I understand, like, not everybody has to go to the most expensive, I would say overly expensive, state school, which Auburn is basically that. But with that being the case, I don't think they all understand, like, business is the calling card for Auburn University. It's that, it's engineering, and maybe some other kind of smaller programs, but those are the two primary ones Auburn excels in. And a lot of these trust fund kids, you know, riding around in a Turbo 911, a G-Wagon. I've seen chocolate Mercedes in my time at Auburn. Not Mercedes, Maseratis, chocolate Maseratis in my time in Auburn. Teslas, you know, just name it. I go outside, I see, you know, a fucking entire row of just luxury vehicles. Those trust fund kids get to get the lesson about money and the value of money, how to earn it, how to save it, how to present your name, image, and likeness in a valuable way in interviews and things of that nature. They get to get that in a very safe, insulated bubble for the majority of their life, assuming they don't, like, coke out in college and go fucking crazy, which I've seen some of them do that. Assuming they don't do that, they get to learn how to acquire wealth in the most insulated way from basically jump street. More often than not, a lot of those people that you do see at 18 riding around a Porsche or fucking Maserati or Alfa Romeo, Jaguar. So this fucking kid, Johni Broome, you know, came up from very humble beginnings, you know, had to earn everything he got, you know, had a miraculous growth spurt from God himself to become, you know, his dream, a real basketball player, grind his ass off in the fucking Moorhead State, which I think was not the AAC, but even below, it's like below like the top level of the mid majors. Fucking Google. So it goes through that, goes through all that, makes it to a Power Five program, that, you know, just lost their linchpin, centerpiece around the rim, and approximates the value of that guy with a significantly worse team. I would say that 2022 was not a great team. and he goes up there and he does that. And then he comes back and improves from that, becomes one of the, like, five best players in college basketball, 5 to 10 best players, depending on how you look at statistics. And, oh my God, the guy that was a mid-second round, you know, evaluation 2 years in a row, like, you know, mid-high second round, could have easily got, you know, $1 million, $2 million, you know, the JT Thor contract on the, you know, the draft market, comes back and plays for Auburn again. And it seems to love Auburn. If you hear all the reports or just hear Johni Broome speak about Auburn, talks about it lovingly. And, oh my God, you have to pay to retain his services? Holy shit. Can you imagine that shit? Can you imagine a fucking kid that's getting $1.2 million, maybe somewhere around that, more or less? $1.2 million, maybe a little insurance policy, nothing crazy, to potentially come out there and fuck up his leg, fuck up his arm. He went through a ton of, you know, a ton of very contentious bumps and bruises the last couple of years. Puts himself out there, plays with heart and hustle and grit, constantly around the board, you know, throwing himself in there. And Auburn has to pay to keep him to come back? Oh my God, that's such a tragedy. It's fucking ridiculous. The discussion about NIL, yes, there needs to be NIL reform. I'm not going to go into that. But the fucking premise that, like, these guys don't earn their NIL, Auburn was a non-existent basketball program for damn near, like, what, a decade? 2 decades, damn near? And you want to sit here and tell me that a guy who's bringing ass to fucking seats and votes, the damn secondhand tickets are going for fucking $300. I think Auburn gets a cut of the secondhand tickets as well. Even to tell me the guy that fucking bringing those ass to the seats can't fucking get a little piece? And it's not even like you gotta give everybody $1 million. You just give the guys that are worth $1 million $1 million. If Omar Barlow is getting $1 million, that means that not too many motherfuckers are getting $1 million. You know, Brian James might get $1 million. You know, guys that are actually, like, you know, as good as Bronny's marketable value, or maybe get $1 million, you know, like fucking, you know, like Mark Sears might get, like, if he comes back, like $1.5 million, you know, maybe. He's one of the best, like, 3-point guards in college basketball. Okay. Makes sense. If you're going to have that motherfucker come back and not go to, you know, potentially do the G League circuit or be like a mid-second round type of guy, you have to pay him a couple million. Does Alabama not have that after going to the Final Four because of Mark Sears? Do they not have $2 million? It's fucking remedial. There's no comprehension of reality in this. It's just people's emotions and lack of empathy. Johni Broome deserves $1.2 million from Auburn. It's not like a fucking... He deserves probably more than that. You look at that team at times. And they had to replace him. They had to fucking pay $1 million to get somebody of comparable value. Like, they're going to get, like, an Omar Barlow type of guy. You have to pay $1.2 million. You're going to get somebody like fucking... God, that was a fire transfer that came out. And there was a lot of really good centers that came out recently. I was trying to think of somebody. But, you know, like last year, for example, like Micah Hanegaalden from Marshall went to Florida. Probably to pay like mid, you know, like 200, 300, 400K for him, probably, I would assume. You got to pay that shit. That's just the cost of doing business and getting high-level players. Anyway, that's the NIL talk. As for the basketball talk, yes, it was the right thing to wait for Broome. As I said, there was like a lot of high level centers, bigs that came out. I think Garrison Matthews was another guy. Cliff Amori, he was a guy Auburn pushed for in high school quite a bit. A lot of really good names that Auburn may have like loosely contacted but did not really push for, as far as bigs go, because they were sitting there kind of waiting for Garrison Matthews. I think it's Brandon Garrison is what I'm thinking about, the guy from OK State. But anyway, just really high level guys that they kind of just did not push for because they had to wait for Broome. They had to do the same thing. This bitch is testing me. I don't use the B word in any reductive way. It's just a friend of mine. A black guy using the B word. Anyway, it's kind of like this. This just like that was the asking price, you know, around $1 million, and you know, if Auburn have to pay that, he might as well at least like try to maybe overpay to get a guy to come your way. After the fact, you know, after Broome like just declares, but when you got the guy, he knows the system more or less. He was a defensive system. You know, what do they say? You have a bird in the hand or two in the bush. I mean, you got the guy, just, you know, like, sitting out, waited out. You know, obviously, if you missed out on him, it would have sucked. You more than likely, at this point, would have been behind in the bargain for a lot of guys of comparable value to Broome. So, he may have been in a situation where he didn't start Cardwell, which, you know, not the worst thing of all time. But, he did the right thing. They waited it out. And he's a guy that kind of, like, cements your plans a lot of other ways. As I understand, from all these rumors I've heard, and it may just be horse shit, but from all the rumors I've heard, he's supposed to be a guy that they're going to look to play at the four. I don't understand the evaluation there. I mean, even before like the end of the season, like I've seen guys say he should play four. I don't get it. I don't get what the vision is there. I'm not like a basketball, like, you know, I'm not Trillion Donovan is like a recruiting guy. I'm not like, you know, fucking whoever, just an evaluator of talent, you know, like Ryan West from the Lakers, you know, like I'm not like a scout, but like, I don't get it. Like, I understand like it's being done in a way to like prepare him for the league. And also kind of like to shore up the loss of Jalen Williams. Like, I get the premise, but I don't get, like, how it's supposed to work on the court. Because, I mean, he's just not a guy that, like, has high-level foot speed, which as an NBA 4, like an NBA 4 right now, Anthony Davis is a 5, but he was pretty much the prototypical, like, 4 for a while. More or less like a stretch big. I guess, yeah, we'll say he's prototypical, yeah, sure. You know, Pascal Siakam. Let's see, who else is I'm just thinking top of my head, you know, like, I mean, even like Bam Adebayo is a 5, right, in this current NBA, which, you know, he probably, if mine going to be better, he probably should be a 5 or a 4, but, you know, it is what it is. And that guy moves like a 3 and has skill set like a 3, but you're gonna have like Broome, who moves more like, and it's no offense to Broome, like, I just, you know, kind of like fucking got on the bike and just rode for Broome for the last like 10 minutes. He has the foot speed of a plodding like 2000s like center. Like, he may move a little bit better than that, especially like kind of like straight line speed, but like side to side, like, he doesn't, I think his best like what allows him to continue being a high level defender even with like his lack of foot speed is his timing. He times and kind of guesses well, like where players are moving very well. Uses his hands well, which, you know, sometimes a little bit fousy, but, you know, he uses his hands well. But it's his, like, side to side foot speed is not like, oh my god, like, it's just, that's not how I would describe it. I understand as a skill set wise why you want him to be a four. Like, I get, like, he's gonna have to be like a spacing big. He does not work well enough in the post. I want people to hear this when I say this. He does not work well enough in the post against true fives, like truly sized fives, to really be like a post magnet, if that makes sense. Like, the post is dead in the NBA anyway, but like, you wouldn't really like say, I'm going to run that set for him. Like you would maybe, you know, Embiid or somebody like that, Jokic, and kind of like the high post look against fives. Like, you put him against Embiid, you put him against, like, really anybody that, like, has the Donovan Klingon frame, basically, which is a lot of centers on the NBA level. That frame, like, he has shown you that he does not operate well against that frame. He's shown it multiple times. He does have good footwork. He does have a bag. You know, I'm not taking it away from him, but, like, a lot of what his bag is centered around is, like, he always has, like, that, like, I'm gonna hit you with, you know, kind of like that little shoulder check, which, you know, feels like a lot when you're going against, like, a college five that's, like, 6'8", 6'9", you know, South Carolina-type centers. When you're Rudy Gobert, it doesn't really do much, you know? And he doesn't have good lift. He's kind of like a push shot on his... It's not like... The flick of the wrist on his hook is not like... It doesn't get much arc. It's a very pushy, kind of straight line type spot. And he doesn't get, like I said, a lot of lift, which that's self-evident. He doesn't get a lot of lift on his shot. So, it's not a guy that I think is going to, like, cook against, like, really good NBA fives. But I see that, like, fours are more of his frame. He should have a theoretical advantage on them. I would say that we have to slim up considerably to even, like, run with fours. And I still think he can run with fours. Like, if you think about a good four right now, like, in your head, just think, like, LeBron James plays a lot of four at this point, right? Aaron Gordon. That level of athlete is going to, who's who he's going to have to match up against to be an NBA four. And he can't do that. So I don't understand. I don't get where that's coming from. But I do understand, like, the offensive skill set is they're envisioning him playing on that level. They're envisioning him doing a lot of, you know, like, high post dribble handoffs. A lot of those looks that he got where he'd be parked in the elbow on one side, the double cuts where he can see it. He can kind of make the pass. You know, he made a few skip passes this year. Made a lot of tight, you know, made some tight passes. He improved in seeing doubles. He was horrendous, you know, 2021 in that. He was terrible. But I would say he was good 2022. Maybe even great. You know, I'm trying to think, like, what a college five would be like in terms of seeing, like, you know, as a college five, I'd say he's probably great in terms of seeing, you know, doubles. But in terms of NBA level, like, but, you know, you got to compare against your peers. You know, that's how a draft goes. You know, you kind of evaluate against your peers and evaluate against the NBA. So as an offensive hub, I would say probably, like, they're going to give him a lot of high post looks, which he got, you know, quite a bit of. A lot of those dribble handoffs he kind of had with Aiden Holloway. This is going to happen with Big East as well. And I hope that Pegues, I haven't really watched a lot of, I watched like 5 minute highlights of like his kind of strengths and weaknesses and based on like his kind of points per possession and shit like that. I mean, he looks good. Like, he looks like your combo guard that can play some point. I wouldn't say like you're going to ask him to really be like Tyler Kolek, you know, or something like that, but like he can be a point, you know. So that type of guy, you know, should work in a lot of those sets that Aiden Holloway ran with him, some of those dribble handoff looks, some of those the counter, like let's say they run the dribble handoff, the high screen, where it comes up where Aiden, you know, would normally get around the top of the key. And then Broome kind of can take that and just kind of, you know, float away if he wants to. A lot of those actions they ran were not actions for, like, the big. Like, Aiden would get it, and he'd either shoot or he'd look drive, but it wasn't, like, a really an action for the center to get the ball back. I would say there's some things they can do with Pegues if he is really, like, a kind of dynamic ball handler, a guy that has a good, you know, a good ability to both cut or drive and shoot. There's some things where you could probably have Broome short roll off the screen. You can have Pegues take it. You know, let's say you run it to where Broome is on the... I hope I didn't just flash my wiener. But basically, you have Broome at the top of the key. Droop a handoff. Pegues is coming left to right. He's getting it, rolling off, cutting, you know, driving to the rim from the right elbow. You have Broome coming for the short roll. Pegues hopefully draws two, and then you just dump it off to Broome, who gets a kind of, he likes that floater, that little kind of floater push shot. He does like that. So there's a lot of things you can do with the ball handler coming off of that little DHO that doesn't exactly just result in shoot or drive, which Aiden Holloway wasn't at the point mentally as a player to really look to run those sets for more than just him doing this thing. He also is probably like more of a traditional shoot two guard in terms of style of play than he is a one. But hopefully Pegues, who has seen a lot more basketball, can kind of run these in a way that also optimizes Broome as a player and as a scorer. And also, I mean, as they get more comfortable with kind of the point, what is his name? CBM. The point Chad looks, which, you know, when you say point, like, people just think like point guard. It's not necessarily that per se. It's just that, like, Chad brought the ball up. You had him kind of like make the first action in the set. Like, it may still be the exact same set that they would have ran with Aiden. But the thing is, like, you run this set with Chad bringing it up, kind of relieves the pressure off of Aiden. He gets to work off ball and kind of, you know, if you're a two guard, like, generally, you're not going to, like, engineer the set unless you're, like, Devin Booker or something like that, you know. But generally, like, you're not going to be the kind of kickstart to the set. Like, the point guard would be that. So you kind of have Chad start the set, Aiden come off a pin down or whatever, he gets the ball, and maybe he has the, maybe we switch into, you know, horn set or whatever after that. But basically, the pressure is off of Aiden actually, like, look to set everybody up. You know, he just kind of gets to be part of the moving pieces as Chad got to set up. But hopefully, the next evolution for Chad can be, like, actually running some, you know, pick and rolls, which he didn't do a lot of as the kind of point guard here. He did a lot of just trying to traditional, like, I'm bringing it up, let's get it going, I'm going to look the score, you know, blah, blah, blah. But if he could run some screens, you know, that'd be nice because he can do some in-between stuff, some uncomfortable layup type things. And he can draw a two, I think, better than a lot of guys on Auburn's team last year could. So if he can do a lot of that, you know, even if it's just draw a two and just do a dump-off pass to Broome, that would do a lot to help Broome out. There's not a lot of creative passers that we've had in the last 2 years since we've had Broome. I would say Trey's probably the best in that regard. But in terms of navigating screens and kind of find the best angle, best spot to kind of get the ball off to Broome if you're going to do that, it's pretty much just been Trey. Yeah, I thought Wendell was a pretty decent, you know, like, scoring guard that could play point. But, you know, you threw a hedge at him, and that was just the end of the whole, like, kind of action between him and Broome. They'd have to reset and do it all again, you know. Hopefully Pegues, like, you can't just, like, throw a high hedge on him and it just kind of, like, kills the play. Hopefully. So that's the basketball thing. I guess to kind of summarize that, I'm glad that Broome is back. It kind of, like, allows you to set your lineups, you know, in a very good way. I don't know about the whole four thing. All I can think about as far as for fours is that, like, maybe they just want to get Broome more minutes and they foresee not getting a high-level backup four at this stage in the transfer portal. So they say, hey, well, fuck it. You know, we're on Chaney as the starting four and then we'll have just a guy come in. It seems they want to say like PJ from fucking Clemson. That's not like really a RJ Garvey, I think his name is. Not like a great get, maybe a developmental one, maybe, but you know. But basically, it's like kind of saying like, do you want to run that guy as your backup four in those non-Cheney minutes, or do you want to run like Chat plus Dylan? I think this has to be more of like a let's get Broome like the looks he wants to get from the NBA type thing, more than it is like a we actually think like Broome is like a four. I don't think they think Broome's a four. I don't think that at all. But if you gotta do what you gotta do, I mean, maybe helps him get him closer to like 30 minutes. Maybe wants more film on tape in a different way. You know, you gotta compromise sometimes. Maybe they compromised people before. Walker Kessler, we had to give him some of those 3-pointer looks. He was fucking terrible at shooting threes, and he still isn't any better at it than he was, you know, when he left Auburn. But we gotta give him the looks, so they have the film on tape, and you know, blah blah blah. And then he moves well. He should move well, Pegues. I would think Pegues is a facilitator, someone between. He's closer to Trey than he is Aiden. Let's just say that. So that should work well for him. There's some good tape on Pegues as kind of a guy that, you know, can dish it out. So, and then, yeah, I imagine some staggering with the second unit. Just kind of allow for a high-level big play in every, you know, moment. If he is going to be a fourth, then he still won't be a bad four option. And hopefully the backup point guard is, you know, as optimal as Trey was. Trey was a fantastic backup point guard. And hopefully we have a guy that can optimize Broome on that bench unit as well. As far as the future, I'd like to get, if we're going to get another big, which we need another big, I'm hoping that somebody can play some five, just so we can have somebody that can develop, because we have two super seniors, and we will be starting a brand new freshman or a transfer guy, which Pearl is going to go for a transfer guy first in that spot. But, you know, I mean, I like some in-house development, you know, it'd be nice, but if we don't, it's not the biggest thing. We just need a big, though, that can play. You can't have Cheney, Darren Scott, Broome, and Cardwell. You need, like, a fifth option there, as we had last year. So I'm hoping for that. And then Darren really wasn't an option last year. That's kind of a guy they just have, like, break in case of emergency, you know, walk on center. You need that, in my opinion. You need another point. That to me, like, what would close out this as being a successful cycle is at least, like, if you thought of Trey as, like, an 8 out of 10 backup point guard, 7 out of 10, I would say somewhere between those two, 7 and 8. You kind of need somebody that's probably like at least a 7. Maybe not at least, but you need somebody that's probably at most a 7. Because Pegues, like, played 30 minutes as a, you know, kind of starter as the other spot. So he's used to playing extended minutes. Auburn doesn't want to play like that, but they can. They can get a guy that, you know, let's say Pegues is close to 28 minutes, while the other guy's like a 12 minute type of guy. They can't play that type of game. But I still would say that, like, just with the nature of basketball, 40 game season, I think you do need somebody that can, like, reasonably masquerade as, like, a starter level type of guy, which is hard to find. That's why you do high school, because high school allows you to get these guys that happen to pay out your ass, typically, that type of guy. That's how you get a Trey Donaldson. But they have to pay for it at this point, because, you know, I mean, you're not going to find a recruit like that. So hopefully I can find that type of guy, just a... It could be a developmental player, what have you. Just somebody that can be a quasi starter as a backup point come like March next year. And then just that kind of, you know, I would probably think at this point it'd be more of a four than a five, but somebody that can play some backup 4 minutes. Because I think they're going to pretty much roll in with Cheney as a starter at this point. And that's about it. A 30-minute video. Glad Broome came back. Definitely some attrition in this previous cycle, but not as bad as I think some people would have expected to be. Some of the guys you kind of thought would have went. It's going to be sad to not see Trey or Aiden kind of develop here. I think those two can both be really high-level guys. But you do have some replacements. You know, you did bring basically everybody you could expect to have brought back. You brought them back. So, you know, I mean, you can't really be too mad about it. You do need to kind of have Pettiford be ready to hit the ball or hit the ground rolling. You know, that can't be a bust. It can't be. At this point, you really can find a guy that can play some quasi one and two. You can find a type of guy, but you can't go in with that guy, Denver, and Pegues. Like, that gives you three guards. You kind of need at least Pettiford to be playable. And I mean playable like every night, not like just, you know, sometimes you can just put him on the bench and just kind of leave him off for a game, which you can do with Aiden sometimes on his low nights. You got to have Pettiford available every night, like ready to go. And you don't have, well, I guess you guys supposed to back up three, because I think Chris Moore's eligibility is Austin. Which, if you have Chris Moore gone and you have Berman gone, that should theoretically mean that you have three spots open, I think. Because you lost, like, and I'm assuming they had, like, the full allotment of scholarships being used last cycle. But you lost Katie, Aiden, Trey, Chris Moore, Jalen, Berman. So that's six spots you lost. And then you only brought in Pegues, Pettiford, and Howard. So even if you brought in other point guard, other big, you have one other spot that I would think you'd like to get filled, but they'd like to pretty much give that spot to a walk on. So it'd probably be to probably 80 Sky, I would imagine. That's who that scholarship goes to. Unless there's somebody that's more senior that just kind of waiting his turn, but both Harper and Berman are gone. It's typically the kind of first off the bench type of walk-ons. So yeah, it probably goes to AD Scott, which I'm like, I don't get the fucking point of that. But I do understand, like, it's like a, it's cool, like, oh my god, it's a good story type of thing. Like, but like, I don't get the fucking point of that. You're trying to, like, make the most competitive roster. Like, fuck that, I don't get it. But anyway, that's gonna be about it. I guess you do, because, like, if you know, people know they could grind their ass off and eventually get a spot, you're most likely to get a high-quality walk-on like Berman was, or Miles Parker. Miles Parker, I don't think he ever got a scholarship here, by the way. I think he was walk-on all of his years, because he came in with Patrick Cook, who was, you know, the kind of the backup point guard he had at times between 2019-2020. And Patrick Cook got that scholarship his last year, but I think Parker's transfer before he had a chance to get there. So I don't know who that went to back at that point. But Patrick Cook was playable. Next name was Cook. He's from Mobile. After him, I don't know who that's. Well, that's when they had the reduction. So it probably didn't go to anybody at that point. But then it went to Berman last 2 years. So yeah, I don't know. We'll see if Scott's playable on that level. It'd be nice. It helps you in terms of like finding that like fifth big. Because if you just get the four right, you can just have the fifth big and just have Scott, like, soak up, you know, someone gets hurt for a little bit, he goes in, something like that. Anyway, that's about it. 32 minutes now and counting. Hope you enjoyed. I can do more Auburn shit. I can do Auburn shit all day. I hope the NIL rant wasn't the worst thing of all time, but fuck it. People need to understand this NIL discussion has so many bad actors in it, especially from the fan perspective.